We had a poetry slam at Beans in the Belfry in Brunswick about a man in pain. And here it is. Hope you enjoy it.
The false promise of youth, 'twill only get better, hardly the truth. 'Twill only get different, like fine wine, you know. You'll slowly ferment and foment as you go. But what do you do along the way, as you evaporate, depreciate, dissolve, and decay? When we awake at birth, why not say, we'll die, why bother? We're told life's not all mirth. What's the point, just to gain girth, having been thrust from our watery mother? Like mowing along, why, for what? It all grows back again and again, to be mowed once more in a new rain. Are we like shoots of young grass aimlessly growing? And is our death our mowing? In truth, we're not so simple, each of us a distinct dimple, some aspect suspect for greatness. If we can just make this success, if we know who we are in life's opera, we can be a rock star in the human diaspora. Does the peer that shakes have it right that it all signifies nothing? Or are we all connected, synapse to toe, one part of another, one with that rock, the rue, the fluttering wings of an eagle, built to soar to unimagined heights, on the winds of dreams regal, meant to sock it to him, win and woo him, to strut among the Broadway lights? When we fell out of our breast-sucked, coddled cocoon, what random doubt made us aim for the moon? Know thyself. I like to talk, to argue. For some, conflict is ague, but I really enjoy the fighting, though now it's mostly writing. Early on, I quickened to fight, watching one caught, unable to fight. Why, just the sight of another fear fraught, a person enmeshed, suppressed, another's unholy mess, moved me to do more, not less. In Miller's Crucible, the Salem witch trial, the court clerk releases a labored deep breath. Surrounded by townfolk, every man riled. Such contention, he says, soon hanging then death. Such contention, always and everywhere. Contention, the lair we must all beware. How to quell the urge to self-immolate, spilling blood to coagulate. So much contention, too little detention. In my case, I was always awed over by those who knew what mattered, their minds a constant rover, not those whose thoughts were scattered. It was the ground of our being, the peace, an ideal worth seeing. Connectedness to the plight, the fight for what's right, suffered in shadows, facing indifference to solitary soreness. Imagine a man in pain, fully at peace only when almost insensate, on meds prescribed, enabling him to suction life by tricking his nervous system to still the storm raging relentless among the miles of nerve pathways, with engines racing rueful baggage to raw receptors, without stop, without end. Contention, contending, confining. Just us agents say, he must be selling. Too many pills for quelling, but the keyhole cops find no selling. Contention, contending, now chasing Richard Pay. Convicted of possessing, though the Percocets percolating drove pain's pain away, so many they said it's really to sell, though the evidence resides only in Pay's body cells. 3 times tried, 10 years spent, convicted, he sighed, in prison, inside, stuck by a jury on a charge that lied. 25 long years, the minimum. A judge directed, if prescriptions flawed, whether pain knew nor not, made his possession outlawed. The amount, way too much a lot. To prison Pay must therefore go to rot. On appeal, I argued, possession ain't selling. No patient's meds unlawful possessing. But only 1 in 3 men in dresses black agreed. So Pay would not be freed. 25 long years, the mandatory minimum. Rats, fury, out of here, so long. We'll write a book to right a wrong. We went south, had to go, to by the sea, Mexico. Laptop in tow, let the rum and coke flow.
My wife Holly did edit my mind-altered prose of the story of Pei and his pain relief dose, of a system indifferent, unaware how fair goes. Plainly we realized these were our foes. Our rummy-fueled book found its way to the governor. He read it. He gave it a look. We wrote a petition. Let Richard go free. They said, come argue. We swelled up with glee. When we entered the marble-floored room, pencil-pushing, tap-tapping reporters arrayed, said, the parole board forecasts doom, so you must be entirely dismayed. Truth slapped with a cold, wet rag hard across the face, our confidence did sag. A sick feeling slowed our rushed pace. We then did say, you'll soon find we're going to change their mind. We rushed the room, grabbed the rostrum. A huge risk did loom. Not time for a thin thought nostrum. We needed a punch to go through the crunch. Ba-boom! Governor Crist, it's quite like this. Your prison doc wrote scripts that rock. Morphine and a pump that in a two-day lump outstrip all those perks that distress the just us jerks. In response, silence reigned. We were anxious, insane. The governor finally spoke. Would he make us all a laughing joke? What if I granted a pardon today? That's what he said. You mean no further delay? The crowd of stranger supplicants, until then distressed and fixed upon their own fate, forgot themselves to join our pleading cries and rants, concerned only that this be Richard's freedom date. Whatever they did fear was forgotten as they stood to cheer. We cried, hugged, anxious and unbelieving. Were our senses now deceiving? Had we found the end of our endless grieving? Was this the day Richard was to go? Loose his prison ties, his wife scream, it's a Rocky movie show. This was freedom, no guile, no guise. The warden said, I'll get him clothes and take him home. No need to wait, no need to roam. Go home, he said, he'll be there soon. And Richard came home that afternoon. 10 years of suffering in hell before his unjust sentence fell. In any one life, is it possible to do better than what's right for another who can't fight against a wrong suffered way too long? It's what I was born to do, what I and my kind of people do, to challenge the rule of thumb world. For our sense of things as they are implies there's got to be a better order. And thank you, Richard, for your courage. You were an inspiration.